Hello friends. In this video lesson, we will look at a practical case in Home Assistant. How to automatically restore the operation of devices that have frozen and stopped responding properly. The situation is, unfortunately, familiar. Suddenly a chandelier or any other device can stop working, and that is always unpleasant. Usually everything is fixed by simply turning the power off and on, so the logical step is to hand over reboot control to the smart home side. But there are a few nuances here that are not obvious to beginners, and I will talk about them too. During the lesson, I will refer to some of my previous videos. The Home Assistant topic is huge, and it is simply impossible to fit everything into one or even 10 videos. You will find all links to the mentioned lessons in the description under this video. There will also be a link to the package with the code that we will go through today in text form, so you can calmly repeat the steps. And before we start, as usual, like this video so it is easier for others who are interested in smart home to find it, and subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so before. In my practical lessons, I try not to reinvent the wheel and not to come up with artificial, theoretical cases. Here it will be exactly the same. I will show a real working package that I already use in one of the rooms. This package is responsible for monitoring and restoring the operation of several devices at once. Two chandeliers, a Xiaomi gateway that I use as a night light, a Broadlink infrared controller, and an Acura E1 switch without a neutral wire. By the way, if you haven't worked with packages in Home Assistant yet, what they are, how to declare them correctly in the system, and why they make it much easier to keep your configuration organized, I have a separate lesson. You will find the link to it in the description under this video. There, in the description, there will also be a link to a text version of the package that I show here, so you can simply open it, copy it, and repeat it on your setup. Thanks to packages, you can collect in a single text file almost any Home Assistant entities, automations, sensors, scripts, switches, and everything else. Therefore, in my case, all the logic of this case lives in one single file, convenient to maintain, easier to debug, and easier to. My package starts with declaring the template integration. It is needed in order to create various entities whose state and behavior are calculated using templates, that is, according to logic that we describe ourselves. You can learn more about creating templates from my video lessons. Links are in the description. In this case, these are binary sensors. They can only take two states, on or off. In total, in this package I have 5 binary sensors, according to the number of devices that I monitor within this package. Structurally, they are almost the same. First come 2 lines, the name and a unique ID. For simplicity, I always make them the same, and most importantly, I never repeat them in other entities. Each object has its own unique name and its own unique ID. Next, the most important part, the condition under which the sensor is considered triggered. Here in the template, I check a specific entity, the chandelier, and if it has the state unavailable, then this binary sensor switches to the on status. But in order not to catch random short-term failures, I add an on delay. In this example, it is 5 minutes. That is, the chandelier must remain in the unavailable state for at least 5 minutes, and only after that will the binary sensor become on. And the last line, device underscore class, problem. This is needed for display in the interface. When the sensor is on, Home Assistant shows that there is a problem. When it is off, there is no problem. This parameter does not affect the package logic in any way, only the visualization. Next, you can see that this logic is simply replicated for the other devices. All 5 binary sensors are made using the same template. Only the name and unique ID, the entity in the template, and the delay time change. That is, how many minutes the device must remain in the unavailable state so that we confidently consider it a freeze rather than a short blink of connectivity. For example, the chandeliers have a 5-minute delay, the Xiaomi gateway has 3 minutes, and Broadlink and the switch have 2 minutes. I arrived at these intervals experimentally. Right after the binary sensors, I start the block of virtual buttons. In the screenshot, this is the input underscore button section. If you haven't encountered them before, I made a separate lesson about virtual buttons a few years ago. As usual, I will leave the link in the description. In this package, there are 3 such buttons. I added them with a very practical purpose, so that you can reboot a device manually, in one click, from the Home Assistant interface. Therefore, I made buttons not for all 5 devices, but only for those where manual reboot is actually useful, for the 2 chandeliers, and for the Xiaomi gateway. And you can do the same in your setup. If you want, you add such buttons. If you don't, you skip this block. The logic of automatic recovery won't break because of that. After the virtual buttons comes the input underscore number block. These are entities that store a numeric value, and in my package there are also 5 of them, one for each device that we monitor. Each has its own unique name, so there are no overlaps. The configuration here is simple. Each input underscore number can take a value from 0 to 3 in steps of 1. Essentially, it is a counter of recovery attempts. Why is it needed? So that the system does not go into an endless reboot if the device has actually failed and the usual turn the power off and on no longer helps. And this is exactly one of the nuances I mentioned at the very beginning. The automation should not only reboot, but also be able to stop in time, so as not to keep cycling the power. Moving on to the most interesting part, the automation's block. Their logic is generally the same for each monitored device, and so as not to jump around identical pieces of code, next I will take one automation and use it as an example to break down all the main parts, triggers, conditions, and actions. And only then, separately, I will show how automations for different devices differ where it really matters. All automations have the same initial block. It's like an automation passport. In this block we have alias, a human-readable name. What is convenient to see in the list of automations, and what makes it easier to quickly understand what exactly this thing does. ID, a unique identifier of the automation for the system. Description, a field for a description. I usually write in simple text what exactly the automation does, so that in half a year I don't have to guess why it was needed. Initial underscore state, the state when Home Assistant starts. In this case, it is set to true, which means after a system restart, the automation will be enabled immediately and will start working without manual enabling. Moving on to triggers, there are 2 in this automation, and both are here for a reason. The first trigger is a periodic time-based check. The automation runs every 5 minutes. Why do I do it this way, and not strictly on the state change of our binary sensor? Because there is a small but real risk that at the moment when the binary sensor switches to on and shows device unavailable, Home Assistant itself may temporarily be in a state where it does not process events. For example, rebooting, updating, or the system is under load. And a check once every 5 minutes removes this risk. Even if the automation didn't run exactly at the moment the problem appeared, it will catch up with it on the next cycle in 5 minutes. The second trigger is a manual launch from the interface. It is tied to our virtual input underscore button. Press the button, the automation starts immediately without waiting for the next scheduled time check. Next comes the conditions block, that is, a set of checks without which the automation will not execute. And this is exactly the moment where we filter out false positives. The first condition is the server operating mode. This is a feature of my specific configuration. My Home Assistant runs on several servers, and this switch is enabled only on the server that is currently active. Therefore, if you have a standard setup with one server, just remove this condition, you don't need it. The second condition is our binary sensor that we declared at the beginning of the package. If it is on, it means the chandelier has already been unavailable for the required amount of time. In my example, those same 5 minutes. The third condition is also very important, the sensor responsible for the presence of electricity. The logic is simple. If there is no power in the house, then absolutely all devices will become unavailable, and rebooting is pointless. Therefore, in such a situation, the automation will not run. But if electricity is present, and this sensor is in the off state, that is, there is no electrical problem, then we move on. And the last condition is the attempt counter. It must be less than 3. If there have already been 3 attempts to restore the device, the automation stops cycling the power back and forth so as not to end up in an endless reboot loop when the device really does not recover with a simple turn off turn on. If all these conditions are met, the automation moves on to actions. And the first action here is exactly a power cycle reboot. In my case, the chandelier is powered through an Acura switch with the key to relay decoupling mode enabled. That is, in everyday life, when I press the key, the relay does not click, the chandelier keeps power, and the chandelier itself is controlled by the smart home logic. But within this automation, we work specifically with the relay. First it turns off, the chandelier is de-energized, then there is a 5-second pause, and after that the relay turns back on, restoring power. The next step after the power toggle is that we record that a recovery attempt has already happened. To do this, I call the corresponding service and increase the chandelier's counter value by 1. This way Home Assistant remembers how many times we have already tried to reboot the device, and at some point, after the 3rd attempt, it will simply stop cycling the power. The final step is needed for my control and diagnostics. I specifically created a separate Telegram channel that works as a technical event log. Automations send messages there about reboots and other service moments. How to create a Telegram bot, how to set it up, and how to send messages to groups and channels. I showed in detail in a separate video lesson. I will leave the link, as usual, in the description. In this case, the automation sends a message that the chandelier was rebooted, attaches the attempt number. It is taken directly from our counter and adds the date and time of the event. Next comes the 2nd automation, and it is also a standard one for each device. Its task is simple. Reset the attempt counter when the device has successfully recovered. The top block here is the same as we already discussed. Alias, ID, description, initial underscore state, nothing new. But the trigger is different. It is tied to the transition of the unavailability binary sensor from on to off. That is, previously the sensor said, device unavailable, and now it became off, meaning the chandelier is available again. Usually this happens right after the previous automation with the power cycle reboot has run. Next is the conditions block. First comes the server operating mode switch I already mentioned, a feature of my configuration. You most likely won't need it. Second comes a check similar to the one in the first automation. Only here we look at the attempt counter being greater than 0, meaning the previous automation ran. If it equals 0, it means there was no reboot. This is possible, for example, if the device returned to the network on its own. And the first action here is simple. Set the counter value to 0, thereby zeroing out the attempt history and preparing the system for the next possible freeze. The second action here is, again, a message to my Telegram channel Smart Home Log. The idea is simple. If the chandelier recovered and the binary sensor returned to normal, the automation sends a log entry that the chandelier is back online and the attempt counter has been reset to 0. And this is very convenient for diagnostics. If in the log you see 3 messages about reboot attempts, but there is no message about successful recovery, it means the chandelier never returned to the available state. That is, the automation honestly tried to bring it back up, but couldn't. And, most likely, the problem is more serious than a typical freeze that is fixed by power cycling. Further down the file comes the next block, 2 automations for the 2nd chandelier. Essentially, they completely repeat what we just discussed. The first automation tries to restore the chandelier when it freezes, the 2nd resets the attempt counter when the chandelier becomes available again. The only difference here is the entity names, a different binary sensor, a different input underscore number counter, a different manual button, and a different relay entity through which the power is turned off. And here the advantage of packages is clearly visible. Such pieces of logic are cloned in just a few seconds, copied, pasted, and replaced the object names. Moving on, now we have an automation not for a chandelier, but for the Xiaomi gateway that I use as a nightlight. If anyone remembers, it's that same round gateway that plugs directly into an outlet. Accordingly, I reboot it via a smart plug, and overall the logic here almost one-to-one repeats what we already discussed, with the exception of one detail that is specific to such devices, although I don't that it may apply to some others too. And here is that small but important exception for the Xiaomi gateway. In the case of the gateway, it is not enough to simply toggle power through a smart plug. Yes, it will reboot, appear on Wi-Fi again, but Home Assistant does not pick it back up, and it continues to be shown as unavailable. Therefore, after the power cycle reboot, I do an additional step. I call the Home Assistant .reload underscore config underscore entry service, and as the target, I specify the entity of this gateway. Only after that does Home Assistant reload the integration entry, and the gateway correctly moves from unavailable to available. And this is a good trick for the future. If after a power cycle reboot some device is physically alive, but in Home Assistant it is still unavailable, try exactly this configuration entry reload service for the corresponding entity. Further down the file is the block for rebooting the Broadlink infrared controller. In Logikit, the automations we already discussed. The only difference here is that I didn't add a button for manual reboot. I simply don't need that for Broadlink. It reboots only in automatic mode. And the relay, through which I pull the power, is the USB output of one of my TUI smart power strips. That is, the automation turns off USB power, waits a few seconds, and turns it back on, thereby restarting Broadlink. And the last automation in the package is the most non-standard, because here we monitor not a device connected to a switch, but the switch itself. This is an Acura E1 without a neutral wire that controls a Zigbee chandelier on the balcony. And the situation here is the reverse of the usual one. The chandelier itself almost never becomes unavailable, but the switch, due to power, periodically goes into the unavailable state. The reason is simple. When the chandelier is off, the switch does not have enough power for its operation, and it becomes unavailable. At the same time, even in this state, it still continues to supply power to the chandelier, which control from Home Assistant. And here is exactly that reverse logic I talked about. To revive the switch, we don't cut power. On the contrary, we temporarily increase the load so that the switch has enough power and it appears in Home Assistant again as available. Therefore, in actions I do the following. First, I turn on the chandelier to 100% brightness, wait 10 seconds. This time is enough for the switch to return to normal. Then I turn the chandelier off again. Then everything follows the familiar scheme. We increase the attempt counter, write a message to the Telegram log, and a separate paired automation. Upon successful recovery, resets the counter to zero. And to make it clear how this looks in practice, here is an example from my technical Telegram channel with logs. In the screenshot, you can see two entries in a row. This is exactly the execution of two automations for the balcony chandelier switch. First, a message that the recovery has been started, indicating the attempt number and time. And then, a message that the switch has been successfully restored, and the attempt counter has been reset. That's all. I hope this video was useful and interesting for you. I would appreciate a like, it helps promote the video on YouTube. And if you don't want to miss new reviews and lessons, subscribe to my channel. In the description under the video, you will find links to all the lessons and reviews I mentioned, as well as to the text version of the package, my social networks, and a group for communication on smart home questions. Join, it will be interesting. Thank you for your attention. See you next time. Peace to everyone.